shine, for they let us come. I'm Minister Michael Kernan, bringing to you a full gospel Christ teaching ministry, which is committed to the uncompromised Word of God, allowing God's people to come out of darkness and into His marvelous light. But first, let us pray. Dear Heavenly Father, open the ears of the people who are listening to this broadcast that they might understand with their hearts and be converted. I pray against all hindering spirits that might try to prohibit your glorious gospel from being effectual and taking root down in their heart. In Jesus' name, I pray, amen. Hallelujah. Devil, that's the devil's job, to try to make this holy word of none effect. But he can't get it done, hallelujah, through faith in Jesus' name. I'm a heart of gratitude. Subject is a heart of gratitude. Thank you, Jesus. What's going on here is we're all going through spiritual warfare. Where the battle is between God and Satan for the soul of man. God and Satan are duking it out for the soul of man. And I don't know if you know anything about a warfare, but I'm telling you, it's not pleasant. I was, there's a general, U.S. general from times past. He said the words that it's a good thing that war is so awful, otherwise we might enjoy it. This warfare that I'm going through, I don't know about you, the warfare I'm going through is not enjoyable at all. It's awful as can be. But you know what? It's going to work itself out. Hallelujah. Where? In my life, in my heart. You just got to get to the point where you just get sold out to God. Hallelujah. A heart of gratitude is the name of the subject. Our battle, my individual battle, is to praise God in spite of the fire. I got to praise God in spite of the fire. Thank you, Jesus. No matter what I got to go through, I praise God and I got the victory over that devil. They're both coming. They're both coming hard. I remember not that long ago, I was going through something and God said, I'm battling for you. I am battling for you. Hallelujah. And he totally meant it. I got to do. My part is not just to praise God. I got to do what he says. Thank you, Jesus. And if you can't hear from him, read his word, and it will speak to you. Right now, he's really pushing on me, leaning on me, saying, read my word, read my word. I was spending too much time on these lessons. He's just letting me know, read my word. I'll teach the lesson. Thank you, Jesus. It gets in there. Thank you, Jesus. It gets in there. Remember, not long ago, our hearts, at least, let me, maybe not yours, you know, but mine. My heart was hardened toward others. You know, back when I was a sinner, I had a hard, cold heart. Dark, dingy, I mean stingy. You know, I mean, it was all about me and nothing about you. It got to the point where, you know what, my friends, my worldly friends, my sinner friends, the ones that, you know, haven't come to Jesus, didn't want nothing to do with me. Even I didn't want nothing to do with me. Thank you, Jesus. But he's taken that. He's taken my heart. And I wrote down, he's tenderized it. He took a stone. Literally, he took a stone and tenderized it. Figure that one out. I can't figure it out. I don't know how he did it. He's a marvel in my eyes. Look at a piece of meat. You tenderize it. It's not pleasant. It takes a little effort. They got these really wicked-looking hammers and different things that you take that meat and you're tender. We're going through trials and tribulation. God is trying to work out that good work in our heart. Hallelujah. He's replacing us from a heart of stone to a heart of compassion. Right now, what he set me up for is to be a pastor. I'm called to be a pastor. And he's given me the heart of a pastor. And that is no small thing. The heart of a pastor, you're going to need patience. You're going to need long-suffering. That's patience. Long-suffering is patience under fire. And you're going to have to put up with some people that will actually, right in the church house, that actually grind you. You know, they cheese you off, and you need to just sit there and bear with it. I'm telling you, it will work itself through. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. God is tenderizing me anyway. Hallelujah. That's why God gave us Jesus. Hallelujah. That's why God gave us Jesus. After all, it is all about Jesus. Who offers us, Jesus offers us truth for confusion, strength for weakness, joy for sorrow, life for death, oil for ashes. Hallelujah. Oil for ashes. Ashes. What are ashes? That's my old man. He got to the point where, you know, like he was just burnt right up, right to a crisp. There was no moisture in my life at all. There was no life. Thank you, Jesus. And he brought me from where I was way back there, my old man, to where I am today. And he's letting me know, you know what? I can bring you the rest of the way, but I got to do what he tells me to do. Through his word, through his spirit, he'll talk with you. He'll walk with you. He doesn't want you to stay like you were. Thank you, Jesus. That's not what Jesus came to do, to leave us like we were, just to cover us in his blood. He's bringing us into this new birth. Now, my old birth produced a heart of stone, but my new birth, thank you, Jesus, is going to produce a heart of compassion for others in spite of how they treat me. And that's not an easy thing. That's not an easy thing. Let's go to St. John 15 and 16. What do I mean by that's not an easy thing? I can't do it without the Holy Ghost. I can't live this life for 5 seconds without his patience, without his long-suffering. You'll see his fruit of the Spirit in Galatians 5, 22 and 23. Love, joy, long-suffering, patience, meekness, you know, temperance, meaning balance. I'm not sometimes up and sometimes down. So people will try your patience. And you know what? If they get the better of you, that means you got flesh. You're in the flesh. You need to be in the Spirit. You need to stay in the Spirit. And when flesh rears up its ugly head, just sit right there and wait it out. Thank you, Jesus. St. John 15 and 16, Jesus said, "Ye have not chosen me, but I have chosen you and ordained you that ye should go and bring forth fruit, and that your fruit should remain, that whatsoever things ye shall ask of my Father in my name, he may give it you." And I was telling you before, what fruit is he talking about? He's talking about Galatians. Galatians 5, 22 and 23. But the fruit of the Spirit. Now these are God's attributes. Absolutely. But he wants to put them in our heart. And the only way he can put them in there is when I allow him to. I got to turn the old man loose. When we die to self, hallelujah, when we turn self loose, when we turn our back to the old man, he'll fill us with his Spirit. And his fruit, his attributes, is love, joy, peace, long-suffering, gentleness, goodness, faith, meekness, temperance. Against such there is no law. And 24, and they that are Christ, I'm calling him mine. And I am his. Hallelujah. Matter of fact, I'm more his than he is mine. You got to give yourself to him for him to be yours. Hallelujah. And they that are Christ have crucified the flesh with the infections and lust. And they that are Christ, see there, ownership. I'm his. And he's mine. We're one. Thank you, Jesus. Have crucified the flesh, the old man, this thing right here, this body. That's what Adam gave us through his transgression. Have crucified the flesh with the affections and lust. Just, I'll share this with you. I got a woman that needs a ride now and then. I just dropped her off. And she asked me, well, you know, I told her, you know, I need to make this quick. I was going to take her to her house, drop her off. I want to do this show. I got things to do. You know, this is after Sunday service, and I'm doing this on my own time, and okay, very good. But it's my duty as a Christian, no, to help that woman out. So, okay, well, can you take my daughters afterward? You know, I need to go to my house, get some meat, and go, you know, and so suddenly I'm the taxi cab. Okay, sure, let's do this. So I get her in the car, bring her to their house, and there's a bunch of people out front trying to jump a car and all this other stuff. And, you know, it's her family, for crying out loud. And I'm like, well, let me go check real quick and see if I can get a ride. She left me sitting there for 15 minutes. 15 minutes. She finally comes up after she realized I'm sitting there still, comes up to me and says, oh, I forgot to tell you, I got a ride. Okay. So, you know what? Help me, Jesus. Help me. You know what? You got to get to the point where don't let that bother you. You're doing what you know is the right thing to do to help people out. People, all people, hallelujah, don't have the same grace of God that you got. Don't worry about it. It will work itself out. Somewhere down the line, that little thing, thank you, Jesus, God will repay me with. And maybe not somebody helping me out in that manner, but him helping me out. He's trying to make me his child. And if I get upset with that, which I was a little bit peeved. I come in here a little hot under the collar, like I told her I got things to do. And some people don't realize anything but themselves. They're so wrapped up in themselves. They don't realize, you know what? I'm taking advantage of a person. And that's one thing. If I got a pet peeve, I'm going to share this with you. I don't like people taking advantage of my good nature. I don't like that. It's inconsiderate. It's not Christian. I'm doing things. I'll go out of my way to help people. And they take advantage of that. And then sometimes they don't even appreciate it. They act like, you know what? I got a thing here going on. I can take advantage of that. No, I don't like that. Now that's my old man. And I pray that God somehow will crucify that part of me. Thank you, Jesus. I'm just telling you a fault that I have, and I'm confessing it before God right now. Work on that with me, Lord. Work on that with me. I need patience. And God was, what was God doing there? He was giving me patience. God can use people to give you patience. There's two ways to get patience. One is waiting. The other is tribulation. Romans 5, 1 through 5. You get two ways to get patience. One is waiting. One is tribulation. And I'm going to tell you, waiting is a lot better than tribulation. Tribulation is a booger. If you've ever been through it, you know what I'm talking about. That's sometimes demonic attack. The devil will attack you. And you're just like, man, what is going on here? Everything's swirling around you. And you know what? If you need patience, go wait in the long line. You got three or four items. Go stand behind people that have five basketfuls of grocery. Wait. Waiting is a whole lot better to get patience than tribulation. God, right there, was using that woman to give me patience. Thank you, Jesus. And I'm sharing that with you right now because it's fresh with me. Thank you, Jesus. But we're all going through this stuff. St. John 15, and I'm going to read 16 again. Ye have not chosen me, but I have chosen you. And sure enough, if you're the called, God will choose you and he'll call you and ordain you that ye should go and bring forth fruit. I show you what kind of fruit we're supposed to bring forth. We're supposed to be kind. People make mistakes. They happen. You might forget an appointment and somebody gets mad at you. That's okay. That woman forgot I was out there. That's okay. Believe it or not, that's okay. I'll get over it. Thank you, Jesus. And bring forth fruit. What kind of fruit? God's attributes. God's attributes. Now, I can't bring an apple to the table and say, look what I've done, God. Remember, Cain and Abel? You know, the sacrifice is of God. What are the sacrifices of God? It's a meek and mild spirit. Doing from the heart that thing you know is right. Not just showing them your vegetables. Oh, look what I brought to the table, God. No, the fruit he's talking about is his attributes in my heart, working them out. Thank you, Jesus. And if I have something that's not like God, I pray that he takes it out. Because it will not produce the kind of fruit he wants. Like I said, I shared with you something that is one of my old man's pet peeves that I still have. And God still got to work on that one thing with me. I don't like being people taking advantage of my good nature. It is really discouraging. And God can work that out. Thank you, Jesus, if I let him. I say this all the time. When we got something in our character that's not like God, here I am, this, well, I'll call it a beam in my eye, to use a parable out of the New Testament, a beam in my eye, and I'm sporting it around town, and everyone sees it in me. I don't care how they act. This is me now. This is what God's concerned with. He's not concerned about people out there. He's concerned about his children, showing the world him and his workmanship that he's put inside of us. He's going to come to you and say, give this up. Give this up. Turn it loose. Turn it loose. And after trials and tribulations, sometimes waiting, but he's going to say, turn, and I'm going to realize, you're right, God. Take this out of my character. It's not like you, and I don't want it any longer. And when you turn self loose, he'll fill you with the fruit of his spirit. He'll exalt you in the glory. Hallelujah. He'll exalt you in his nature. That is the new birth. And that's what all this world is producing in us. Thank you, Jesus. Ye have not chosen me, but I have chosen you. I wasn't thinking about Jesus when I got saved. Hallelujah. I was thinking about number one. What do I got to do to get this boo-hoo spirit out of my heart and ordain you that you should go forth and bring fruit? He doesn't want us to just be pew sitters. I was going to say this and I forgot, and the Lord put it back in my heart. What's more important right now? Me doing that good thing to give that elderly lady a ride, or doing this show? In the eyes of God, me doing that good thing. This comes second now. Hallelujah. Listen to this. That ye should go and bring forth fruit. And not just any kind of fruit. God's fruit. Hallelujah. And that your fruit should remain. You know what? If I sat right there and let that thing beat me up, who's got a hold of me? Satan. Flesh does. He won that battle. He run that round. Not God. And I'm going to sit there and let him beat me up? No. The heart of gratitude. The heart of gratitude. The message is the heart of gratitude. Thank you, Jesus. And I pray that this anointing that I'm feeling right now, that this burning in my heart comes over that television set and gets inside yours. And you're going to sit back and remember, oh, just yesterday I did this. You know what? It don't have to be like that. That devil, when you got flesh, the devil can beat you up. When you're in the flesh, that devil can beat you up. When you're in the spirit, he can't touch you. No, I know. I've been through it. That whatsoever ye shall ask of the Father in my name, he may give it you. I got an account with God, okay? I have an account. You have an account with God. Thank you, Jesus. And we can go to that account every once in a while and say, Lord, I can reach the throne of grace for myself. I don't need my pastor. I don't need my pastor's wife. I don't need the prayer of saints. I can reach it for myself. Because I and God are in communion. Hallelujah. I speak to him all the time. When you go through trials and tribulations, you don't got time to wait and call people. They might not be home. And you know, and they're not going to even identify with what you're going through. But God knows. God knows. Hallelujah. 17. These things I command you. Here we go. That ye love one another. It's a command. It's not an option. We're not talking options here. We're not talking principles even. This is a command. You do this, and God said, you will have life. You don't do this, and sin is at the door. Sin is at the door. And Jesus said in St. John, where was it? St. John 8 and 34, I believe it is. I'm going to go ahead and turn there. St. John 8 and 34, whosoever commits sin is a servant of sin. You're going to be his servant. So I'm going to walk around with a bad attitude all day. Oh, how dare she? Doesn't know. You know what? Get over your funky self. I had to. Thank you, Jesus. God can use that situation to work something out in my character. And I praise him for it. A heart of gratitude. I praise God in spite of the fire. I praise God in spite of the inconsiderate people being inconsiderate toward your time. It's not about nothing. He's not worried about that person. He's worried about me. They're going to have to go to the throne of grace for themselves. They're going to have to appear before the judgment seat of Christ for themselves. I can't stand for them. They're going to have to stand on their own and face God Almighty on the throne of judgment one day. And so will I. Thank you, Jesus. These things I command you, that ye love one another. If the world hate you, ye know that it hated me before it hated you. We just got to get over the fact. The world don't love us like it used to when I was a teenager. You know, I've been going through this since 17 years old. I'm 53. 53 years old. You know, God called me out at 17, and I didn't answer that call. I didn't want to hear it. La, 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 la. You know what? When the problems don't go away, you got to address them. You're going to have to get to the point where, you know what, this la, 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 la thing don't work anymore. When you're under demonic attack, thank you, Jesus, it makes this life very real indeed. I will tell you that for sure. And you need to get to the point where you just start addressing those problems. And that problem is, am I right with God or am I not? If I'm right with God, why am I going through this? And you, I'm telling you, if I can do it, you can do it. You can talk to God straight. Hallelujah. No intercessor other than the Spirit of God. Hallelujah. Our intercessor, hallelujah, is the Spirit of God. Thank you, Jesus. If the world hate you, you know that it hated me before it hated you. The world hated me, hallelujah, but it hated Jesus first. In another place, Jesus said, you know that the world hates me because it hated him who sent me. They hate God. It's called, carnal-minded. Carnal-mindedness. We're thinking with our carnal way of thinking. You know, it says it's enmity against God. The carnal mind is enmity, a deep-seated hatred against God. You got to get to the point where you either believe what the word says or you're going to call it a lie. You can't sit on the fence and expect good things to happen. You're either going to have to get on God's side or you're going to have to get on the devil's side. And God's still going to battle for you when you get on the devil's side. I'm telling you. If you're a child of God, you're going to go through this for the rest of your life. And if you just get to the point where you got a heart of gratitude, when the devil jerks at you, you're going to just go flick. And it's not about nothing. This life isn't about nothing. Thank you, Jesus. Remember, the world... Remember the word that I said unto you. The servant is not greater than his Lord. Excuse me, I went too far. 19. If ye were of the world would love his own. You see there? I got this saying I heard a while back. When we were 20, we were worried with what the world thought of us. Why? We were in the flesh. I know I was when I was 20. I wasn't thinking about Jesus back then, and I was worried with all what all these people thought about me. You know what? The time we become 50, we realize that the world wasn't thinking about us at all. They don't care if you get saved. They don't. They don't care. You know what they care about? Themselves. The world cares about number one, and that ain't God. That's themselves. They're selfish. I'm telling you, the world is selfish. And if you see somebody selfish, pray for them. Pray that God crucifies that flesh. Thank you, Jesus. If you were of the world would love his own. But because you're not of the world, but I have chosen you out of the world, therefore the world hates you. The world hates you now. Here's something that I found by practical experience. When you pray to God, Lord, I want to be your child. The devil heard it also, and he's going to come. And he's going to do everything he can to try to knock you off. Not necessarily physically, but spiritually. He's going to put his spirit and sinners that surround you, different people. And they're going to act up in the flesh, and they're not going to treat you right. And you're just going to have to get to the point where, you know what? How is it between me and God? Remember the word that I have, 19. If you were of the world would love his own. But because you're not of the world, but I have chosen you out of the world. You see a little jealousy? The devil, you're no longer his. You're walking away from him. He thought he had your soul. I said this battle is for the soul of mankind. It's no small thing. Therefore, the world hates you. Thank you, Jesus. That's okay. You just got to get to the point where, you know what? How is it between me and you, God? And he will tell you. He will tell you. Thank you, Jesus. When you're living godly, expect to come under attack. When you're living godly, you might as well expect it. You're going to come under attack. And if you go to 2 Timothy 3 and 12, it says, yea, and all that will live godly in Christ Jesus shall suffer persecutions. You got to get to the, what are persecutions doing? I know what they're doing. They're crucifying your flesh, which is like the devil. That's what Adam gave us. His transgression gave sinful flesh to all of mankind. And Jesus said in Luke 9:23, if any man will come after me, call himself a Christian. That's what that means. If any man will come after me, you're going to call yourself a Christian. That's what he's saying. I mean, they weren't calling them Christians back then, but they are today. If any man will come after me, let him deny himself. We got to turn our back. This is a purpose-driven thing. This is intentional life. If there ever was intentional life, you got to deny self. Pick up your cross daily. Matter of fact, don't put it down. You know what? Somebody gets the best of you, pick up the cross. Put a smile on your face. Give God a heart of gratitude. Give God a heart of gratitude. You know what? That shouldn't have bothered me at all. That shouldn't have bothered. What happened earlier, just before I sat down here, shouldn't have bothered me at all. I should have been grateful that God would allow him to use me. Right? Isn't that the Christian character? Thank you, Jesus. Yea, and all that will live godly in Christ Jesus. Christ before Jesus is our risen Savior, the victorious one. Jesus Christ, think of him as the Lamb of God, made to be taken and crucified for our sin in the flesh, that we might be one with God. Hallelujah. Christ Jesus is our risen Savior. I can go to him in prayer and he can tell me. He can also calm me down. There's a song that says, sometimes he calms the storm. Sometimes he calms his child. I don't know if it was the other way around. But you know what? Sometimes he's not going to calm his child. We got to go through the storm. And we just got to get to the point where you're like, okay, Jesus, what did I learn from this? Patience. Patience, my son. In your patience, possess ye your souls. Luke 21 and 19. In your patience, possess. That means you're controlling your soul. You have control. You have self-control. When we were in the world, we were incontinent. We had no self-control. I know I didn't. Incontinent means you can't hold back. You do me, I'm going to do you. Right there and then. It's on. That's how I was when I was in my teen and in 20s. And I look back to the man I revile my old man. I revile him. I look back to him with disdain. But thank you, Jesus, I'm not him no longer. I'm my new man. I am what God is making me to be. And God can get it all the way done. I know where he's got me now. And he's put me through a lot of trials and tribulations right now to give me a heart of a pastor. But let me tell you something. When I become a pastor, I'm going to go through some more. But God has big plans for people that he works on. He wants you to be his child. And that's no small thing. And the devil knows that. And he's over there gritting his teeth. Oh, you think you're all that? No, I don't. My righteousness ain't of me. It's of God. And that's Christ in me. Now, there comes a time where I need to start exhibiting, you know, showing that nature off to a lost and dying world that don't know God. They don't know God. Don't expect them to act godly back toward me just because I'm acting godly toward them. God hasn't started that good work in their heart yet. It's up to me to be patient with them. Thank you, Jesus. Yea, and all that will live godly in Christ Jesus shall, not maybe, not possibly, shall suffer persecution. And you just got to get over the fact that the world just don't love you no more. Boo-hoo. Oh, Lord, how long I hear these Christian songs on the radio. Ooh, you know what? You can stop that boo-hoo spirit by getting with the program, by selling out to Jesus, and he'll take that from you. He'll take that sad sack spirit from you, and you'll be over there. I know when I first came to church back in, I was 26 years old, was I? Yeah, 26. I come to the church sitting in the back row with my hands in my pocket, looking at all the people in the front, praising God and shouting and snotting, and I'm in the back row, ooh, God don't love me. Well, you know what? I didn't love me. My friends didn't love me. The world didn't love me. You know why? Because God was calling me out. God was calling me out. Way back there with that sad sack spirit. When all hell breaks loose, turn your gratitude toward God for the things that he has done. Turn your gratitude toward God for the things that he has already done. Jesus said on the cross, it is finished. The cross is complete. Huh? The cross is complete. It will crucify sin in the flesh. But we got to pick up ours until the day we die. We can't turn it loose ever. That's something you just got to get down on the inside. And the spirit of heaviness will flee. That sad sack spirit, the spirit of heaviness will flee. Go to James 4 and 7. The heart of gratitude. That's, you know what? We're all battling it. I know years ago, things weren't going right. Nothing was going right. And I'm sitting there with this little, you know, boo-hoo thing. You know, I'm not right. You know, I'm looking to God, you know, oh, Lord. And you know what? He took the time to speak to me. He said, praise me now. Praise me now. And I'm thinking he's mocking me. I'm thinking, I didn't understand it at the time. I had no understanding of what he was talking about. Praise me now. He's showing me how to get the victory. You praise me now, and I'll start working that sad sack spirit out of you. The situations aren't the problem. Your heart is toward me. Thank you, Jesus. See how that works out? He said, praise me now. And the joy of the Lord, Nehemiah 8 and 10. I got that coming up right here. Nehemiah 8 and 10. The joy of the Lord is our strength. Don't you think the devil knows that? You know the devil knows how to read this book. He just can't live this book because it's not his nature to live this book. God's given us his divine nature through his spoken word. Where is it? It says the engrafted word, I don't know where it is right now, the engrafted word is able to save your soul. This right here is enough to save your soul from the devil's nature. And God, the devil knows that if he can keep you sad, if he can keep you boo-hooing and snot and crying and fussing and, oh God, how long? He knows you got no strength. And he can take his little boots and walk up one side of you and down the other. He'll do it with sinners. He'll do it with possessions. He'll take your possessions. He'll take this and he'll, whatever you put value on instead of God, he'll take it from you. And then he'll sit over there and let you watch somebody else play with it. Oh, look what I got. And you're just sitting there gritting your teeth. You know what? You're playing with the devil, you're going to lose. You're playing with sin, you're going to lose. It will not work. It's not designed to work for a child of God. The world is just fine with sin. I don't care what the world does. I'm not concerned with the world anymore. What is the world? Those are sinners. Those are the devil's children. God's not even concerned about them right now. When he's working on me, he's focused. He sees me, he's working on me. When he sees you, if you're still listening to this program and you want to be a child of God, he's concerned with you. Don't worry about what the world's doing. They're going to do their thing, and they're going to do it with gusto. I know when I was in sin, I did it with gusto. Why not now that I'm a child of God, live this life with gusto? Hallelujah. I mean, full out, not ashamed of who my Lord and Savior is. Thank you, Jesus. But fully letting everyone know, you know what? And I'm doing it not just with my mouth, but with my deeds, with my heart. Putting my heart on a sleeve. Somebody wants to take advantage of it, I'm like, oh, well, God, how is it between me and you? And he'll say, yay, son, yay. Hallelujah. That's what I'm looking for. That commitment from God, because he's looking that from that commitment for me. When I'm all of his, he's all of mine. We're one in the spirit. And that devil, he can cut all he wants, but he ain't cutting in on this one. I don't turn God loose. He says, I will not turn you loose. I will not turn you loose. God said, in the scripture, I believe it's Job, God will not cast away a perfect man. What is perfection? Number one, putting a zipper on it. That's James 3:2. Just put a zipper on that lip and allow God to get that work done in your heart while you're going through stuff. Just zip it up. You don't need to be chiding with people. Oh, I'm going to give them a piece of my mind. Well, good for you. You just backslid. You just are showing now the devil's nature to a lost and dying world that don't need to see it. They've seen it. They got it up to here. I can't count how many times in my life I've showed people Christ in me just by how I am, by me being God's workmanship. And they come to me and they say, hey, what is different about you? Why are you so happy? Why aren't you mad? Oh, I know you wouldn't be mad about this, Mike, but oh, I'm, you know what? Just you show them Christ in you and you can lead them by example. And then there's going to come a time when they're going to come around and say, Mike, pray for me. I'm going through. Great. Now, share the word. Don't just sit there. Just don't pray for them. I'm not praying that situation goes away. No, I hope that situation increases. Yeah. You come to me and say, make this situation go away. I'm going to pray, God, save their soul. And God knows what to do with that situation at that point. Thank you, Jesus. Submit yourself, James 4:7. Submit yourselves, therefore, to God. Nothing's going to happen. You can cry all you want. You can get self-help books. You can go online. You can Google it. You can frugal it. You can Freud it. You can bake it. You can shake it. It doesn't matter. You can shake it. You can bake it. You can fry it. You can bake it. It doesn't matter. Whatever you want to try to do, you got to submit yourself to God. Step one. Step two, resist the devil. You can't give in to the devil for a second. That's picking up your cross. Somebody comes to you. Oh, I know how I can make $1 million. And you look at it and it's a scheme. Let's call it a Ponzi scheme. Help me get it started. No, don't take no part in that. That ain't godly. No way. And he will flee from you. You're going to say, oh, you just spoke the law? No, no, no. I spoke God's divine nature. You're going to love others. You're going to treat others the way you want to be treated. That is the law of Christ, the law of love. You're not going to do that to somebody else if you wouldn't want them to do it to you. In other words, resist the devil and he will, what? Flee from you. He will flee from you. He's not going to hang out with somebody he can't touch. He's not going to hang out unless there's flesh wrapped around me. And then he's going to have a party. He's going to do it at my expense. I'm not ignorant of the devil's devices. Thank you, Jesus. I'm not ignorant of the devil's devices. God is not obligated to change your situation until he changes you. God is not obligated. Matter of fact, he'll just let right there and let the devil pull a bam bam on you. Devil's going to grab you by your ankles. Bam, 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 bam. You know? And you're just going to sit there and, oh, how long? No. You know what? God is not obligated to change your situation until he changes you. I'm talking that stony heart that I had in me once. It's no longer there. It's no longer there. A heart of gratitude. So I'm going through all these different things. You know, I can't even count them all. This. You know what? It's working out in me what God would have to work out in me. Thank you, Jesus. He wants us to speak to the mountain. God wants us to speak to that mountain. That, you know, in his eyes, it's a molehill. You know, poof. To us, it's huge. Oh, Lord, look at this thing. He wants us to speak to it. Why? Because he's putting his power inside us. And we will get to the point. I know I'm there now. I can speak to situations. And you know what? If I do what God tells me to do, they will go away. But you know what? When they're not going away, it's because I'm not doing what God tells me to do. Healing is the children's bread. Healing now is the children's bread. And you say, oh, I know when I first got saved, or even before I got saved, I thought nobody's going through this. I'm the only person in the world that ever went through this situation. I couldn't believe all the stuff that was happening. I was just, one thing after, if my pastor used to say, if it's not one thing, it's a t'other. It just kept coming and coming and coming and coming. It was relentless. The enemy is relentless. Listen to this. I'm talking about what Paul had to endure. You want to go to somebody that endured some stuff. Look at Job and look at Paul, the apostle Paul. Why did Paul endure so much? Well, you know what? He must have had a lot of pride in his heart. I know I did. That's why, you know what? That pride ain't going to the glory. Thank you, Jesus. 2 Corinthians 11:24. I'm going down to 28. Of the Jews, five times received I 40 stripes, saved one. They whipped Paul. They physically whipped Paul nearly to death. Three times, I was beaten with rods. That don't sound too pleasant. Rods? Uh-uh. I'm not talking bamboo. I'm talking rods here. I don't know exactly what rods were, but they sound pretty metallic to me. Once I was stoned, sure enough. And it says, you know what? They're all the disciples were all standing around. They threw them out of the city. I'm not going to read that particular one, so I'll try to remember it for you. They threw him out of the city after he did something, stoned him, and his disciples, the disciples of Jesus, Paul's companions, were standing around him looking at a dead Paul, and he came, stood on his feet, went back into the city, and then left the next day in front of everyone. They all just stood there probably like, they probably thought they were seeing a ghost. Thrice I was suffered shipwreck, and one of them is in Acts. A night and a day have I been in the deep. Oh, yeah, he was out there. He was dead. He was a night and a day in the deep. In journeys oft, meaning he's all over the place, in perils of waters, in perils of robbers, in perils by my own countrymen, in perils by the heathen, in perils in the city, in perils in the wilderness, in perils in the sea, in perils among false brethren, in weariness and painfulness, in watchings often, in hunger and thirst, in fastings often, in cold and nakedness. Besides all those things, if that wasn't enough, besides all those things that are without, that which comes upon me daily, the care of all the churches, the care of all the churches. Paul had a lot on his plate, but look what all Paul did. Thank you, Jesus. When you're going through a lot of things, I'm telling you, God's got big plans for you. That suffering is going to produce a powerful anointing. And when you speak, people are going to listen, and they're going to be attentive to your word, because you know what? It's not me speaking. It's Christ in me speaking through a chosen vessel of God, a chosen obedient vessel of God. I don't want to leave obedient off. I got to obey what God tells me to do. And he's going to use this chosen vessel mightily. Watch it happen. Watch it happen. I'm going to Acts now. Acts 16. This is how Paul responded to that stuff. This is one example. Paul said, do as I have done to you, and the God of peace shall be with you. I leave you an example. Do as I have done to you. Live like I lived before you, and the God of peace shall be with you. This is Acts 16 and 16. I'm going on down quite a ways. And it shall come to pass, as we went out to prayer, and it came to pass, as we went to prayer, a certain damsel, possessed with a spirit of divination, met us, which brought her masters much gain by soothsaying. The same followed Paul and us and cried, saying, these men are the servants of the Most High God, which show unto us the way of salvation. Patting them on the back. And this did she many days, not just one, many days. But Paul finally had enough. Now Paul, he could see in the spirit. He could hear in the spirit. Paul was the man here, being grieved. He had enough. He just had enough. Turned and said unto the spirit, I command thee, in the name of Jesus Christ, come out of her. And he came out the same hour. And when her masters, you can also call her handlers, you know, they were merchandising her gift, as they would call it. And when her master saw that the hope of their gains were gone, they caught Paul and Silas and drew them into the marketplace unto the rulers and brought them to the magistrates, saying, these men, being Jews, do exceedingly trouble our city and teach customs which is not lawful for us to receive, neither observe, being Romans. And the multitude rose up together against them, and the magistrate rent off their clothes and commanded to beat them. And when they had laid many stripes upon them, they cast them into prison, charging the jailer to keep them safely. You think you had a bad day at the office. Paul was doing what was right. Paul was doing what God told him to do. I guarantee you, after many days, Paul didn't speak up. God did. And God will tell you what to say in that hour, what to do in that hour. You know, Paul got to the point where he was grieved in the spirit. That means the Holy Spirit was chewing on his ear, letting him know, Paul, speak against that spirit now. And when they had laid many stripes upon them, they cast them into prison, charging the jailer to keep them safely. Who, having received such a charge, thrust them into the inner prison and made their feet fast in the stocks. Here we go. Name the a heart of gratitude. This is Paul's response. This is Silas's response. They were comforting themselves. Hallelujah. It's not good that we should be alone. But we are never alone because we have the Holy Spirit. But these two men now, they're in a bad situation for doing the right thing. And like I say, you think you had a bad day. I had a little incident. Just, I'm thinking, man, this is nothing. What am I crying about? What am I worried about? It says in one place, you have not yet resisted under blood, striving against sin. Jesus did that for us. Hallelujah. And at midnight, Paul and Silas prayed and sang praises unto God. And the prisoners heard them, and suddenly there was a great earthquake. Business ready to pick up here now. God's ready to show who's boss, so that the foundations of the prison were shaken, and immediately all the doors were opened and everyone's bands were loosed. And the keeper of the prison, awaking out of his sleep and seeing the prison doors opened, he drew out his sword and would have killed himself, supposing that the prisoners had fled. Let me tell you something. Back then, back in those days, you messed up. You got it bad. Here's an example. In the Roman armies, if you were caught lying, they would put what they called a ravenous beast in a bag and wrap it around your head and make you and basically let that thing have its way with you. If you got caught lying, they'd put like a raccoon or a badger or something in a sack. They probably carried them around in cages to show people this ravenous beast. You lie, this gets wrapped around your head. You're talking pretty bad judgment. So this jailer knew, you know what? My life is, I'm not going to go through what they're going to do to me if all these prisoners are escaped. Listen to this. And the prisoners and the keeper of the prison, waking out of his sleep, seeing the prison doors open, he drew his sword and would have killed himself, supposing the prisoners had been fled. But Paul cried with a loud voice. There's another place. There's a place that says, mercy rejoices against judgment. I'm going to teach that someday. Mercy rejoices against judgment. Paul here had mercy. He could have said, nah, you know, you mistreated me. No, you put my feet in the stocks. You're going to get yours. That's not a child of God. But Paul cried with a loud voice, saying, do thyself no harm, for we are all here. And when he called for a light and sprang in and came trembling and fell down before Paul and Silas and brought them out and said, sirs, what must I do to be saved? Hallelujah. God getting his glory from a heart of gratitude. God's getting his glory from a heart of gratitude. It seemed pretty dark for them, but they had a heart of gratitude for the things that God had already done in their lives. Hallelujah. We are God's workmanship. Ephesians 2 and 10. And brought them out and said, sirs, what must I do to be saved? And they said, believe on the Lord Jesus Christ, and thou shalt be saved in thy house, his family. And they spake unto him the word of the Lord, and all that were in his house. And he took them the same hour of the night, and washed their stripes, and was baptized, he and all his straightway. And when he had brought them into his house, and set meat before them, and rejoiced, believing in God with all his house. You see the favor of God there? So, I'm going to leave it at that. God changed that jailer's heart. I guarantee you, this man, you want to see, it's a tough movie to watch. I watched it one time. I don't got the stomach for it. It's called Mel Gibson's The Passion of Christ, where they beat, the Roman army beat Christ to a pulp. I swear, I just got to the point where I couldn't watch no more. I'm like, and you know, the Holy Spirit said, this is as close as you'll ever see to what they actually did to Jesus' body. It was that bad. But you got to realize now, these men had hearts of stone. Hearts of stone, just like when I was in the world. I was just like one of them Roman soldiers. And maybe not quite that bad, but you know what? If the devil had me long enough, I would have been. I guarantee it. If the devil would have had me in that position long enough, I would have been. I'm sure of it. I would have enjoyed that. I mean, but by the grace of God, there go I. Thank you, Jesus. But he didn't. God called me out at a pretty tender age. Not that I didn't get saved until 31. You see a lot of running between 17 and 31, don't you? The opposite way of God, doing the devil's bidding. God had mercy on me. Thank you, Jesus. But his grace lifted me up and made me who I am today. His grace is his sufficiency, 2 Corinthians 12 and 9, to work out those attributes in my heart in spite of who I was at that point. Thank you, Jesus. You can either believe what God said or call it a lie. But sitting on the fence ain't no good. I'm telling you, sitting on the fence will not work. unless you're the world and you're not living this life anyway and God hasn't called you. You got to get to the point where you just flat out believe God. And I'm going to turn real quick to Psalms 107. This started out as Psalms 107. But everything else, God just throws this at me now. He says, read. I sat down and this just fell out. Thank you, Jesus. Psalms 107. Oh, give thanks unto the Lord. A heart of gratitude. Oh, give thanks unto the Lord, for he is good, for his mercy endures forever. His mercy endures forever. Thank you, Jesus. Let the redeemed of the Lord say so, whom he had redeemed from the hand of the enemy. What enemy is that? Satan, the devil. He redeemed us from that old nature. And he brought us to a place where, you know what? I don't care. My old man is crucified. What he used to do, I don't even care about it. It doesn't bother me no more. My conscience is clear, is because, you know what? My conscience is clear. My conscience is clear because the good work God has done. I don't do those things no more. Thank you, Jesus. It's not who I am anymore. That's why I praise God. I'm going through all this stuff, but I have a heart of gratitude because God took me and brought me to where I am today. And he said, you know what? I'm going to get it the rest of the way done. I'm going to make you my child. Now do what I say. And let me tell you something. God is no joke. He'll do it. He'll get it done in spite of whatever is coming your way. And I'm going to leave you because I'm out of time. Psalm 19:12-14. Psalm 19:12-14. Who can understand his errors? Cleanse thou me from secret faults. Keep back thy servant also from presumptuous sins. Let them not have dominion over me. Then shall I be upright, and I shall be innocent from the great transgression. Let the words of my mouth and the meditation of my heart be acceptable in thy sight. O Lord, hallelujah. How does it go? My Redeemer. O Lord, my strength and my Redeemer. Now may the good Lord richly bless all your sincere efforts that you might lead a quiet and peaceful life and go out there and live victorious and show a lost and dying world the good things that God has done in your heart. In Jesus' name I pray, amen. Thank you. Lord, shine your light of love on me. Nothing else could make me.